I am extra happy this morning to welcome as my guest, kind of a flashback person in my life, a gentleman that is an estate planning attorney from back in my Wisconsin days, from a firm, Reuterware in Wausau, Wisconsin, attorney Mark Munson. He is just like me, I feel, a natural born advocate. He's motivated to have a meaningful, really impactful conversation with his clients and their families. He focuses his practice, and we'll be talking today about the area of elder law. What is that and how families can be impacted by that? So he helps them with public benefits. In addition, special needs trust for those families that need that as well, estate and trust planning, as well as taxation. So Mark finds himself regularly advising clients in the areas of asset protection and medical assistance eligibility, as well as probate and estate administration, trust administration, and tax. Mark is a certified elder law attorney by the National Elder Law Foundation, which is the only organization accredited by the American Bar Association for the certification of elder law attorneys in the United States. So welcome, Mark. I am excited to be reconnecting with you, and thank you for joining me today.
Well, thank you, Marie, and likewise, I'm very excited to be reconnecting with you and having this opportunity to share some insights on elder law with your listeners.
Wonderful. Well, I think we both are a little bit aligned from the standpoint of the more we can educate folks, the better they can be prepared for some of the things that life throws at us. And elder law may be a term specifically that's not real familiar to everyone. So that might be a good starting point for our listeners to hear you kind of share what is elder law anyway.
Sure. So elder law really is we like to think, as elder law attorneys like to think of it as a holistic practice for seniors and for those who are disabled. So, you know, we certainly are looking at legal aspects of things that are involved in the lives of seniors, but care aspects, you know, the care that they need. Unfortunately, as we grow older, we may become more and more dependent on others because our physical health declines or our mental health declines due to things like dementia or Alzheimer's, or sadly too, it could be a combination of both things. And so as our independence may decrease in our aging years, that means our dependence on others goes up. And that's really, I think, the genesis and the focus for elder law is that as somebody's care needs go up, as they're perhaps no longer able to take care of themselves and live independently as they have their whole life, what do we do to make sure that this person is properly cared for, their wishes are honored and respected, and so really that's elder law. It's not just looking at, you know, the legal aspects of their lives or the legal documents that they may need. It's about that, but it's also about the care they may need, the maintaining dignity and respect and individuality to the greatest extent possible, and resources. What resources are available to the elderly, and what sort of care levels do they need? When we talk of long-term care, there's this range of in-home care, assisted living care, nursing home care, respite care. You know, if a family member's providing the majority of the care, what happens if that family member wants to go on a vacation? What do we do in that scenario? Heaven forbid, what if the primary caregiver child has something happen in his or her life where they're no longer able to provide this care to the parent. What's the plan? What's going to happen to mom or dad if that happens? So it's really this holistic planning of looking at mom and dad's in elderly, the senior generation's situation and figuring out what we want to have happen for them.
So you're touching on one of the common fears that we all have is the lack of independence and or the getting ill or a decline in both the physical and the mental health. So in my financial planning practice, for example, focus point planning, that's part of the what if conversations that I have with families. So then that's when they're deciding what to do about it. Part of that can be legal advice and documentation and changes. That's where your elder law practice would come in. So then the common question is, okay, when does a family need to even start thinking about that? How soon is too soon or too late or soon enough to be starting to have those conversations with you about elder law planning and actually taking action?
So a great question, Marie. I think, over the years of time and experience that I have, I would definitely say that, around age 55 or 60 is a fair age to start at least having a conversation about long-term care. Statistics right now bear out that the likelihood of needing long-term care for the average American is 70%. So, the statistics are of life and death is 100%. We know we're going to pass on someday, but 70% of being touched by the long-term care industry is a pretty high statistic. Mm-hmm. And it's one that people probably should pay attention to and plan for, ask questions, get those questions answered, and figure out what happens if I do have to go to a long-term care home and it's going to cost $9,000, $10,000 a month. I mean, that's a big deal. And the sooner you plan for that and have conversations for that, the better off you're going to be. In terms of incapacity, no longer being able to make your own decisions, the planning for that is honestly relatively simple. If you don't plan for it, where do you wind up? You wind up in a place that no one wants to wind up. It's called court. We have to go to court. We have to get a guardianship or a conservatorship for you. And it costs money. Going to court, when you've got to go to court, you're in front of a judge, and we have to get someone who has legal authority to act for you. And to avoid that, to avoid having to go to court, which people want to do, then to do that during your life is do power of attorney documents, do a power of attorney for finances, name who you want to name to handle your financial affairs if you can no longer do so. Name a power of attorney for healthcare. Who do you want making healthcare decisions for you? They don't have to be the same person, but having those documents in place goes a long way because they're designed to help keep you out of court if you can no longer make your own decisions. So doing that pre-planning, for incapacity, dementia, Alzheimer's, being in a car accident and coming out of that with a brain injury, it doesn't mean you're deceased, but it does mean you're no longer able to make your own decisions. If you can't make your own decisions, you need to legally authorize somebody to do so. Every state has power of attorney laws, so everybody can do this. But if you don't do it, we're going to wind up in court.
I had a really sad story recently right here in Arizona that exact, as you were going through that exact situation where a couple was in a car accident, and these folks are in their 40s and had actually met with the estate planning attorney for the first meeting, and were between the first and the second meeting where you go in and sign everything, and had no power of attorneys in place, and the husband had a traumatic brain injury in the car accident. So exactly, the conservatorship and the guardianship, the wife had to go through both of those.
Yes.
Paperwork intensive, expensive, very frustrating situations, and so preventable.
Court is not the place to be. If you can avoid having to go to court, please, please do so. And these documents are important, being in estate planning my entire life as an attorney. You've heard the saying of anything can happen to anyone at any time. And that's absolutely true. And you don't think when you're 40, you need estate planning documents. Mm-hmm. But if you follow that line of thinking of anything can happen to anyone at any time, such as an accident at age 40 and a traumatic brain injury, power of attorney documents would have been helpful. Another common misconception that I'll just share in these situations, and your case touches on this perfectly, Marie, is that spouses think that, oh, well, because we're married, I can, if my spouse has a traumatic brain injury, I can access his or her 401k or IRA, and any financial advisor will say, no, not unless you're properly legally authorized. So it behooves all of us to think about getting some of these documents in place.
Yes, you're exactly right. And as negative and horrible as this whole COVID situation has been, I feel like if there's nothing else that we've all learned from this, is exactly what you just said. Anything can happen to anyone at any time. And this year just proved that to the max, where we would have never even conceived the possibilities. So right. You're right. Planning in advance and the assumption that, well, we're married, I'm sure I can do everything I need to for my spouse, is so not the case in every single state. So you started to talk about another question I have, and that's, what are some of the common misconceptions that you kind of consistently see when you're talking to families that are coming in over and over again?
Sure. Well, it's easy for me to start with what do most people want through planning, and then we can kind of cover misconceptions.
Yeah.
So,
great.
Doing this again, coming out of law school, I've been able to do this and it's what I've wanted to do. So I've been able to do it since I've graduated. So unfortunately, I've done it for a little while now, but. There are generally five things that, I could sit down and talk with anyone about. And one of these five things, but usually it's all five, people will say, yes, I want that considered as part of my planning. So one of them, and this is age old, we've heard it forever, is to avoid probate, mm-hmm. right? One of the reasons to do planning? Well, to avoid probate. Well, what is probate? Probate's the court supervised, that means we're back in court again, the court supervised process of transferring a deceased person's assets to someone else. But it's through the court. And we say, can we avoid that? It's just like the guardianship and conservatorship. Can we avoid that? Yes, we can avoid it through power of attorney documents. Can probate be avoided? Yes, you can do planning to avoid probate. So that's one area. Another area is certainly taxes. If I say to somebody, is it on your estate planning agenda to reduce or eliminate taxes legally? Absolutely, it's on my agenda, okay. So third is asset and creditor protection. Are you interested in that? Well, most people are going to say, yes, I'm very, very interested in having my assets protected and preserved. Fourth is, would you like things to be easier for your spouse or for your children if something should happen to you? Mm-hmm. Yes. You know, the old adage of KISS, keep it simple, stupid. But people, that's a reason to do planning, because if you don't do anything and things are scattered and mismatched and all over the place, it makes it hard for someone to pick up and take over your affairs, whether you're incapacitated or deceased. So, you know, making it simple for someone else. And then lastly, probably most importantly, is making sure that your wishes, whatever they are going to be honored and respected. So it's kind of those five things of probate, tax, asset protection, keeping it simple for the next person, and you know, making sure that whatever your wishes are, you know, if you want to leave a little bit to charity or leave something to kids a certain way or grandchildren a certain way, making sure that your wishes are honored. So that's what I see that people want, you know, something within those five or all five of those objectives or goals. So one of the common misconceptions that's out there, especially in the elder law space, is long-term care, the cost of long-term care, and, well, my husband's already in the nursing home, there's nothing I can do, or my mother is already in the nursing home, we're too late to do any planning. And that's simply not the case. And this is a very, very, very lawyer cliche thing to say, but I'm going to say it. If someone is in a care home where their costs, their monthly costs are exceeding their monthly income, which, okay, I mean, for most seniors, if they're in a care home and it's $9,000 a month, you know, their income doesn't equal $9,000 a month. For seniors, their income is maybe $1,000 or $2,000 a month. So if there are assets in a case like that, there's generally planning that an elder law attorney can do to help preserve and protect some of those assets, A, for the senior, but B, for their family. And most seniors, if you ask them before they really got into a care home, and would say, you know, if there's a way to preserve and protect some of your lifelong assets for your children and qualify for a government benefit to pay for your long-term care, and it's long-term care that you want, wouldn't that be preferred? And people will say, yes. So, you know, a lot of elder law, Marie, is planning for uninsured long-term care costs. Medicare doesn't cover long-term care. Medicare covers hospitals and doctors, but it doesn't cover long-term care. And a lot of times when people get to me, they're at a place for long-term care where it's either cost prohibitive, they're not going to buy it because of the cost, or they're not even insurable for it. They're too old and they won't get underwritten for the insurance itself. So then the only opportunity that a elderly person or couple and their family have is legal planning. If insurance planning is not available, either because you can't get it or it's too expensive for you in your own mind, then the only way to deal with uninsured long-term care costs is through legal planning. There's really no other way.
I think your point about it's not too late just because one of a couple is receiving care is definitely one of the misconceptions out there. And so people don't even have the conversation. So that's one takeaway I'm hoping our listeners are hearing from what you're sharing, is that a conversation is a crucial key starting point, because most of the time, like a lot of subjects, we don't know what we don't know.
Always, always. And, yes. and Marie, let me just add on that if I could,
because sure.
I hope this information is important and valuable to your listeners. But in the case of a married couple where one of them has to go to the nursing home, you know, immediately the at-home spouse, the spouse who is still at home, should have immediate concerns about his or her financial viability moving forward. Because if the spouse in the nursing home is costing $9,000 a month, that's a big deal. And as a general rule, many of the couple's assets can be preserved and protected for the benefit of that spouse at home. There's a set of laws out there, both federal, so all 50 states have the same rule, but also the states have rules as well that prevent spousal impoverishment. And so, you know, these rules are out there. They're designed to protect these spouses at home. And the people that really, really know these laws are elder law attorneys. That's what we deal with day in and day out. And it is amazing the way that the law is set up, that it can be so beneficial for this spouse at home. You know, in fact, I often say to clients and families that call me in this situation is that my starting point is to say, okay, we're going to look to protect everything for that spouse at home and get the spouse in the care home qualified for benefits as soon as possible. And that's available. That's, mm-hmm. you know, people hear a lot of, oh, there's this 5 years and we can't, you know, because my spouse is already in the nursing home or my mother's already in the nursing home, we don't have 5 years. So there's nothing we can do. That's not the case. There's always, again, very lawyer cliche thing to say, but if there are assets available, then there's always something that we can do.
That should give everyone hope and hopefully prompt the conversation. I think estate planning in general is one of the biggest back burner areas of our financial lives. And then the elder law piece specifically is our brain just doesn't want to think about it. And we think it's not going to happen to us. But
and it's overwhelming. It is overwhelming. I mean, I think the biggest relief that we can provide, you know, that I've seen is, you know, you could say, for example, to a spouse, don't worry, we're going to do X, Y, and Z. We're going to do the medical assistance or Medicaid application. We'll be the one that talks to the state on your behalf. We'll take care of this for you. You just focus on taking care of your spouse or taking care of your mother. And they find that as a huge, huge relief. Oh. You know, in addition, it's worth mentioning for the married couple and the spouse who is at home, you know, yes, we could preserve assets so that spouse has financial independence. It doesn't have to worry about losing everything to the care home. But in addition to that, you know, it's an important message for me to share is that spouse at home really needs to think about updating his or her estate plan, because I can almost guarantee that the estate plan of the spouse at home says, if I die, everything goes to my spouse of 50 or 60 years.
Exactly.
Well, if the spouse of 50 or 60 years is already qualified and on medical assistance, And the healthy spouse happens to, or the at-home spouse happens to pass before the nursing home spouse, and we leave everything to the nursing home spouse, we've kind of defeated all the medical assistance, Medicaid qualification that we did for the nursing home spouse. So that again, that need for planning, that need for thinking ahead, well, what if, very unlikely that the at-home spouse dies before the nursing home spouse dies, but it can happen. Anything can happen to anyone at any time.
Right.
And it's best just to plan accordingly using that mindset. Anything can happen to anyone at any time.
Absolutely. And that's not a common thought that I think goes through most families' minds. They're focused on in the moment, the one that's needing the care, and not thinking past that. So
statistically, Marie, absolutely. Chances are the nursing home spouse will pass before the at-home spouse. But have I seen it happen where the at-home spouse passes before the nursing home spouse? Yes. And if the old estate plan is in place and we have everything go to the nursing home spouse, they're going to lose their medical assistance.
Right. So many things.
That's not good planning. And that's where, you know, we can help. And that's where, I guess having that knowledge and experience can be helpful to a family.
Absolutely. So many good points you brought up, Mark, and I'm hoping our listeners at least take away the idea that it's really wise to have the conversation, to understand your situation and the ramifications, and then go from there. So if folks want to reach out to you or find out a little bit more about elder law in general, is there a resource or a best place to reach you or catch up with you further?
Well, sure. I think my email and phone number will be broadcast or shared
in the show notes. Yep.
I'll leave that up to you, Marie, but okay. I'm not licensed in all 50 states.
Sure.
I think, you know, at least from the legal side, a good place to look for information is, NALA, which is the National Academy of Elder Law Attorneys, NAELA. NALA is a good resource. Many elder law attorneys throughout the country belong to that organization, and it's a good place to help find an attorney.
Right.
If you're looking for specialists, you know, I'm not sure how we're not supposed to use that word all the time, but as you mentioned, because it's just been a focus of a practice area of mine, that being elder law, another organization that's out there is, and it's actually in Arizona, is NELF, the National Elder Law Foundation. And that's the organization that does the certifying of elder law attorneys, or the CELA, Certified Elder Law Attorneys. So from a legal perspective, that's where you can get some information about elder law.
Wonderful. Well, thank you again for helping us to clarify and understand a little bit more about a very confusing topic that we really all need to be much more aware of. So I appreciate your time, Mark, and thank you for all you're doing for helping families.
Well, thank you for having Marie and letting me share some of this information. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much.